on time.
All right.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen.
Thank Jesus. You.
Thank you, Lord.
That was a song of testimony.
Uh-huh.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, 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 Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Just about how we, who are God's greatest creation, made from the earth, are receptacles and incubators of that which is planted into us. And we have to make sure that we plant God's word in us so that there's something that's strong in us that can sprout and come out of us to create a firm foundation.
Yes.
And the more word you have in you, the stronger the foundation you have. This Sunday, I want to move up a little higher and talk about walls, walls of the house. It becomes interesting when building a house, when we have the foundation set and it's cured a little bit. Reverend Akers, you can then go on and start setting the walls. And you know, when it takes time, you start framing up the walls and getting your 2x4s together and your nails and looking back at your blueprint and the plans. You know, that you then began to set the wall. And it's interesting, though, when we have people that come to Christ, one of the most vital and important verses of scripture, I think every new believer should have is that verse out of Jeremiah chapter 8, where God says, "For I know the plans I have for you."
Yes.
Plans to prosper you and to keep you, because we don't often remind people that just the same way in building a house, the architect has plans, that the architect of the universe has plans for us. And it becomes necessary for us to make sure that we're putting our house together according to those plans.
Amen.
And so this morning, I want to talk about the walls of faith.
Yes.
When you think about a house, when the wind blows, it's the walls that keeps the wind off you.
Yes.
When you think about a house, when you think about dust and all that stuff, leaves and all that stuff that gets blown by the wind, it's the walls that catch that and keep that away from you.
Amen.
Amen.
When we think about our Christian faith, we have to have strong faith in order to stand in the midst of storms.
Amen. Jesus.
That's what brings me to our text this morning, because Jesus has just finished feeding the 5,000, is taking time to get away a little bit with his disciples. And so he makes a statement, Reverend Akers, that sounds to some like a question, and for others, like an inference. He says, "Let us go over to the other side." They get in a boat to go over across the water to the other side of the shore. And you know how it is. You start something and you have an intended destination, but there's no guarantee of what is going to happen between point A and point B.
Amen.
You can start school and say, in 4 years, I'm going to graduate. But you have no clue as to what's going to happen from the the day you enroll to the day you graduate, you're going to endure some storms.
Yes.
You can say that I'm going to start this, or I will, in the morning I'll start that, and I've got this intended thing, but that plan that you have, you know, nobody plans for storms.
That's right.
No.
I'm of the mindset that nobody plans for storms in our lives. But it's interesting when you start to building houses. Brother Raymond, I found out that depending on where you live in the country, you find different types of houses.
Yes.
You know, it was interesting when I moved to Virginia, everybody used red bricks. I said, oh my goodness, everybody got a red brick house? Everybody? You know, because in Florida, you see all manner of houses and all manner of colors of houses. You can have a red house, you can have a green house, you can have a yellow house, you can have a sandstone house, you can have a gray house, you can have a light blue house, a dark blue house, a light green house. But people build their houses out of different materials and use different designs, sometimes based on where they're building the house, because they're building it with the expectation that the house is going to have to withstand some stuff.
Yeah.
And so the building codes in Virginia are different from the building codes in Florida, because there's different weather in Virginia than there is in Florida.
Yeah.
In Florida, there are certain hurricane codes that in the building plans that you have to be adhered to. You have such to be able to withstand so much wind.
That's right.
Yes.
It's got to be able to withstand so much rain.
Uh-huh.
In Virginia, you don't have that issue. Right. So they're different building codes.
All right.
That's right.
And so we have to understand when we start to look at building our spiritual lives and building our spiritual houses, that based on what God has planned for us, that we have to get in His Word and make sure the foundation that we have set will handle the house we need to build.
Go ahead.
Right. And when we start building the walls, we need to make sure that we go back to the architect that asks him what's necessary for us to have within our house, so that when the wind comes, we can stand the storm.
Yeah.
We talked about last week about the three little pigs. The problem the first two pigs had was that their houses could not withstand the storm.
That's right.
And when we see people in life today, and there are some people who look at people, you say, I went through what they're going through, and I survived it, and it swallowed them up. That's because their house could not withstand the storm.
Amen.
In the text this morning, Jesus is sleeping in the bottom of a boat.
Uh-huh.
His disciples, who've been walking with him now over a year, watching him heal people, watching him deliver people, watching him raise the dead, watching him stand up to the Sanhedrin and all other people, they've seen him do stuff. And they've heard his word.
Uh-huh.
And they've seen him heal people even by speaking the word. So they know there's power in his word. And by his word, he says, let us go over to the other side.
Uh-huh.
They have enough faith to get in the boat. But the problem comes that when the storm started to rain, they didn't have enough faith in what he said to believe that they were going to get to the other side.
All right.
How'd you get that, Pastor?
Mm-hmm.
Look at what they did.
Good.
They ran down into the bottom of the boat and got mad with Jesus because he was asleep in the midst of a storm.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing wrong with sleep.
No. Let me back up and say something right here. Jesus is not crazy.
That's right.
We would look at this, and through our natural eyes, we say, something wrong with him.
Uh-huh.
Sleep in the middle of a storm.
There you go.
Something wrong with this deal. We need to get him down and get him checked out.
Uh-huh.
However, there's nothing wrong with Jesus. What we found out is there's something wrong with the disciples.
Uh-huh.
Let me tell you why I say that. Because Jesus, in his statement in verse 40, sets up for us something that all of us need to pay attention to.
All right.
See, here's the issue. We look at the story and we get happy because he says, peace, be still. But here's the revelation to verse 40. In verse 40, Jesus gets mad with them because they had the same power that he had if they had faith to say the same word and get the same reaction. Maybe the reason and you're going through what you're going through, it's because God is waiting for you to speak to the storm, because he gave you the same power that he has. Because man, remember, he prays in John chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16, and said, Father, endue them the same way you endued me.
Uh-huh.
When the wind and the water comes.
Uh-huh.
Now, let me back up and say this, because I don't want to make light of that situation. Peter and some of these boys, Andrew, they were fishermen.
Uh-huh.
So remember, they had seen a storm before.
Oh, yeah.
And when you got experienced fishermen on the water and they've seen a few storms, there are little waves on that. Don't matter. That don't mean nothing to them. They can stay out with little waves.
Mm-hmm.
But then another hurricane.
Uh-huh.
Waves crashing over the boat.
Yes.
Now, what Jesus is trying to get to them is just because the wind and the waves look bad, it doesn't mean that my power is diminished.
Amen. All right. Amen.
See, the issue that we have is, as long as it's a little wave, we all right. Because God can handle a little wave.
All
right.
But when the big wave comes, we get fearful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He said that if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, you can say to the mountain, be thou removed.
Yeah.
And it's got to go.
Uh-huh.
If you got a little faith.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I had to look it up because, like, you know, I'm not from the city, from the country. So I had to go into the store, to a store and get buy a pack of mustard seeds one time. Because I just want to see, you know, this idea of faith and mustard seed, and have a mustard seed faith. I just want to see how much faith that was. When I saw how small the mustard seed was, all right. I got embarrassed. Hi, my name is Kevin. I just want to be honest and say there have been times in my life that I have not had the faith of a mustard seed.
Amen.
Some of y'all have too, but I'm going to be honest with all of you. Because the reality of it is, if I have the faith the size of a mustard seed, right. It does not matter the storm, for my faith will keep me in the midst of the storm.
Uh-huh.
In the text, it says that the great wind, the storm, came upon the boat. And Jesus was in the boat asleep. And they asked him, Master, don't you care that we're going to die?
Mm.
The problem is faith.
Faith.
Mm-hmm. See, my faith is a thing that keeps me when the world around me is going crazy.
Yes.
Faith. Now, let me be honest. I was calculated and moving to this point and to the next point on next week, because I had to start with where I was at last week.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you don't have God's word rooted and grounded deep in you, you do not have enough faith in God to believe that God can handle your circumstances and your situation.
Right.
And the problem some of us have is the problem that they had. They had heard the word and were okay as long as they could see it with their own eyes. But now they were in the midst of a situation where they got Jesus on the boat with them, and they still believe that they're going to die.
Oh, yeah. Read it. Dick.
Jesus is on the boat with them.
Uh-huh.
And they still believe they're going to die.
Yeah.
I don't upset anybody this morning, but he said, in Matthew chapter 28, and Lord, I'll be with you always.
Yeah.
Even until the end of the earth.
Yes.
Yeah. We still got a sun?
Mm-hmm.
We still got a moon?
Mm-hmm.
Birds still flying?
Oh, yeah.
Flowers still growing?
Yeah.
Still got grass when we get ready to cut it again in a few months?
Yeah.
Cars still running around?
Yeah.
Kids still riding bicycles and shooting balls and going to school, all that stuff still going on.
Yeah.
So the earth is still here.
Yeah.
So the earth is still here. Jesus is still right here with us.
Yeah.
We, I know all y'all ever listen to is Christian radio. But there's a song by Michael Jackson that I was wondering sometimes, I don't know what I'm saying about it, but it's got this song, You Are Not Alone.
Yeah.
I'm here with you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nowhere far apart, you're always in my heart. I like that song. Yeah. And, you know, I know y'all looking at Pastor and I hear you talking about Michael Jackson in the pulpit. But I believe when you listen to the words of the song, that sometimes we ought to remember that Jesus sung that song first.
All right. All right.
That's right. Because Jesus said, well, I'll never leave you nor forsake you.
Amen.
I'll never. Him who said, let there be, and whatever he said was. Him who said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, and you act on that faith, you can do anything.
Uh-huh.
He says to us, I will never, and even when you don't deserve it, I'll never leave you.
All right.
Even when you mess up, I'll never leave you.
Yes.
Even when it gets dark at night, I'll never leave you. Even when it gets dark in the daytime, I'll never leave you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you always.
Thank you, Lord.
So you got Jesus in your boat.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
With you.
Mm-hmm.
You have power with you.
Yeah.
You have peace with you.
Yeah.
You have love with you.
Yeah.
All the stuff that you need is right there with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All you have to do is speak.
Yes.
Speak.
Mm-hmm. If you got the word in you, what's in you comes out.
Yes.
When the storm comes.
Uh-huh.
It's like baking a cake.
Mm-hmm.
You got to put all the right stuff
in
the batter.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes heat to the batter.
Mm-hmm.
For everything to get a proper position, mm-hmm, so that when it comes out of the heat,
right,
other people can tell you what you put in it.
Yes.
Let me help you.
Yeah.
You ever made a cake? I had somebody taste the cake and then they go back, oh girl, you put this in the, ooh child, you did that.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't put it in there, if you didn't put the flour in there, or if you didn't put the eggs in there, or if you didn't put the sugar in there, if you didn't put the milk in there, and you put it in the heat, when it came out, it would not be fit for consumption.
Amen. Right. Right.
It won't rise the way it's supposed to rise. It won't set up the way it's supposed to set up. You won't still look like after what it's supposed to look like. It won't taste like after what it's supposed to taste like. If you don't have enough word, God's word in your heart, so if you have enough faith in the midst of a storm, you can't say, oh, taste and see. That the Lord is good.
Yes.
Which thing?
He's sleeping in the bottom of the boat.
Mm-hmm.
They come down here mad at him because they think he doesn't care about their safety and their well-being.
All right.
But what they don't understand is because he has already spoken that they're going to the other side, the grace of God, the protection of God is resting all around them. And though the boat may get a little wet, they cannot sink. They cannot not make it to the other side.
Jesus.
We have to have faith.
Yes.
Yes, we do.
It is the walls of faith that keep our house together.
Yes.
The Bible says, by faith, Abel at all offered up a more excellent sacrifice than Cain.
Mm-hmm.
By faith.
Mm-hmm.
It says, by faith was the world for. By faith, when Abraham laid Isaac down, believing in the promise of God.
All right.
By faith.
Right.
Hebrews chapter 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Yes.
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 Faith.
Faith.
My belief in God, my belief in what I've read, my belief in what I've heard, my belief in what I've hidden in my heart are the things that keep me in the midst of a storm.
Uh-huh.
We built a house.
All right.
You put up walls.
Mm-hmm.
And then it could be storming outside.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be all right because you have enough faith to believe those walls of that house are going to keep what's outside from coming inside.
All right.
My faith is in what I have on the inside. And so if I put God's word on the inside and I faith in God's word, then I can stand in the midst of the storm believing that God will deliver.
Yeah.
We just sang that song. He's the on-time God.
Yeah.
That's a testament of faith.
Yeah.
He may not come to when you want him, but he'll be there right on time. He's an on-time God. You can't say that if you've not lived there. You had to have some moments.
Yeah.
When the water was about to roll over your boat, but Jesus stood up and said, "Peace, be still in your life." You know what I'm saying? That's all. And so now I sing it in experience and expectation.
All right.
In experience because I know in the past he's done it before. But in expectation because my faith says that since he's done it before, he'll do it again.
All right.
You got to have faith.
Thank you, Lord.
Faith helps you to stand. And, you know, you can always say, I always say this, people that have faith go through stuff and they don't open their mouth, you never know.
That's right.
Thank you.
That's right.
They still come to church.
All right.
They still love people. Mm-hmm. They still give to people. They still care about people. Mm-hmm. And it's not until you take the time to ask them to sit down with them that you find out what's going on.
All right.
People who don't have faith, the moment something happens, they stop coming to church.
Amen.
People who don't have faith, the moment that something happens, they fall apart. Now, let me stop and say, it doesn't mean you don't cry. Because as a Christian, you're going to cry some
more.
I love God. I believe in Jesus. I know that God has got me with everything that I go through. But when my great-grandfather died, I cried.
Amen.
Oh, I kept it together throughout the service. I kept it together throughout making my remarks. I kept it together then. But when it was over, I had to go somewhere and cry a little time.
Yeah.
But my crying was not despair because I said, I'll never see him again. I got this hole that'll never be filled. My crying then was just an admission, Ron Akers, that it hurt.
Yeah.
But it was not that I did not have hope. Because the Bible, the book says that there will come a day.
Will.
And there will come a time
will.
When the trumpet will sound.
Yeah.
And the sky will open.
Yeah.
And Jesus will come back.
Oh, yeah.
And the dead in Christ shall rise.
Oh, yeah.
And we who are still here will be called up to meet him in the air.
Yes.
So my faith gives me strength to keep going even though he's not here.
Oh.
Why do you have no faith?
Oh.
Church is going to take faith. They keep putting one foot in front of the other.
Yeah.
Each and every day. It's going to take faith. To keep saying to a dead and dying world, there is a better way.
All right.
It's going to take faith.
Yes.
We got to have faith.
Yes.
When people look at you and they ask you, how you got over? It's takes faith. They just sing a song when I was a little boy. It takes faith to step out on nothing and believe that something is there.
Right.
Faith. Here's the thing. When you have faith in God, you then understand that God has faith in you.
Oh, yeah.
Let me say that again. When you have faith in God, you will discover that God has faith in you.
All right.
Where do you get that preaching? The Bible says that Jesus came and died, was dead and buried for 3 days, and he got up on the third day morning. The disciples went to the tomb after Mary told them, and they found that his body was gone. The Bible says then that they were fishing on the water, and that Jesus came out to them, and that he sat down and made a breakfast. He had a discussion with Peter during breakfast that morning and asked Peter, "Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me and feed my lambs? Peter, do you love me and feed my sheep?" It looked like in that moment they were picking on Peter. And what he wanted Peter to understand was just because Peter had fallen, just because Peter had made some mistakes, it didn't mean that God was going to give up on Peter, because there was still work that he was going to trust Peter's hands to do.
That's right.
Jesus remembered how he said earlier, "Simon, Simon, Satan desires to have you."
Mm-hmm.
to sift you as wheat. But I pray for you that your faith fail not. I pray for you. Isn't it interesting? Jesus prays for us.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
But then he goes on to say something that we don't always talk about. He says, and when you're converted, strengthen your brothers. You're going to go through some stuff. And Jesus has an expectation that you will have your faith where it needs to be so that when you go through the storm, you can stand up and be all right in the midst of the storm.
All right.
But when you get through the storm, that's not when you're a converted part. When you go through the test, that you will be willing and ready to give your testimony to somebody else right. So that your testimony strengthens their faith. Faith leaves no room for fear. Faith leaves no room for fear. I remember hearing somebody say one time, if you're going to have fear, you can't have faith. If you're going to have faith, you can't have fear. For the Christian, God loves us. He cares about us. He gives us eternal life. But he also gives us something extra. See, we forget that it's not just about giving our life to God. Because after Passover, 50 days after Passover, Pentecost comes. We celebrate Easter. And many of our churches do nothing about Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost Sunday, 50 days after Passover, you celebrate Pentecost. Because Pentecost, and this is not just New Testament, this is Old Testament, there was a feast that they celebrated on Pentecost. It's in the Bible. You can look it up. Google it. Bing it. Do whatever you got to do. If you don't believe me, it's there. I promise you. But 50 days after Passover, Pentecost comes. Pentecost is the visitation of the Holy Spirit upon God's people. When Jesus got ready to leave, he said, I will not leave you comfortless, but I will send you a comforter, and he will bring all things to your remembrance. This is why we have to study to show ourselves approved. Because you say the word, you have the word in your heart, and in a moment of testing, when stuff happens, the Holy Spirit reminds you that you read that word that says, I'll never leave you or forsake you, and your faith stands up, and the water doesn't overflood you.
Amen.
Faith. And we have to have our house wrapped in faith. We need faith. Faith not in who's our president. Faith not in who's our congressman or senator. And I'm not telling you not to vote. I encourage you to vote. But if the vote doesn't go your way, don't fall down. But don't faint. Because even if the vote does go your way, it doesn't mean they're going to do what you want it to do. Want them to do. But you have to have faith. Faith not in your finances. Because every economist will tell you that live long enough, eventually your money will get funny and your change will get strange. So not faith in that faith, not in your health. Because every doctor will tell you, I don't care how good you look, I don't care how strong you are, eventually your health will fail you.
Yes.
Faith not in family or friends. Because time will tell you that as long as the time keeps on ticking, that family will fall away, friends will fall away, and you will may wake up one day and find yourself left all alone. But faith in God, because there the Bible says that by these two appealable facts, that we are all made to be true, that our God cannot die.
Yeah.
And he cannot lie.
Yeah.
So in his word, he says that it's by faith. Hold on to your faith.
Thank you.
Stand on faith.
Yes.
Build the walls of your house with faith.
Yeah.
You got to read and study that word, hide it in your heart so that it grows out as a wellspring.
Mm-hmm.
And then it will build walls of faith.
That's
so you won't just hear the word, but you'll live the word.
Live it.
So you just won't see a sermon. You'll live the sermon.
Amen.
So you just see, because coming to church is not like watching TV.
That's right.
All right.
Being a Christian is not like watching a movie. It's not a monologue where I talk and you listen. It's not even a dialogue where I talk and you talk back. It's not a trialogue where God speaks to me and I speak to you and you speak back to me. But it's a quadrilogue where God speaks to the man of God speaks to the people speak back, not just to the man of God, but to God himself. Why is that necessary to bring that up? Because when you speak peace, be still in the midst of a storm. It's like God is like a parent. You get a baby and you just rocking that baby and you're protecting that baby. You tell that baby to call you mama or daddy. And you tell that baby to call you mama or daddy. There's an expectation that you're planting the seed in the baby to understand the relationship. But all that day, that first that they raise their hands and they say mama, or they raise their hands and say daddy, you get so excited. You get so happy because that they are repeating your words back to you. So you know they understand what you're saying. You know that they understand the relationship. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
God, I believe, gets happy when we speak his word back to him. We know that you hear his word in your heart.
Yes.
He is excited.
Yeah.
But it takes faith. It takes faith for us to stand on what God said and believe beyond a shadow of a doubt.
Mm-hmm.
That come what may, whatever be time, God will take care of you.
Yes, he will.
Beneath his wings of love above, God will take care of you.
Yes, he will.
You just have to have faith.
Yes.
Faith in his word, faith in his power, faith in his presence, faith in yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have faith.
Thank you.
As we stand all over the room.
Yeah.
As we begin to sing, I invite you to have faith.